Let's stand as we begin our time of worship together. Just a matter of a few days away.
share with us this morning?
There's definitely no snorkel necessary. Just let it go over the anchored BPS program. And see where to go to dive it.
So, what do you think of our Shakespearean actors here? I hope they did a good job. Let's give them a hand. Thank you, Darren, and thank you, Alan. We appreciate that. Just a little taste of what our Vacation Bible School is going to be like this year. The theme is anchored, where the kids were deepening their faith in God. It's going to be a one-day-only event this year on Saturday, July 24th, from 9 to 2, right here at Bethel Park, a beautiful location. So obviously one of our prayer requests is, Lord, please give us a beautiful day so we can be out in the field for games and just have a good time together. So if you have any children in your family, your neighborhood, or your any outreach that you might have, children who please grades K through 5, they're welcome to come. And we can go back up planting seeds at range. We're not anticipating that. We're not praying for that. But we'll go back to church if it would happen. So if you were interested in having any flyers, you had something you were handed with your bulletin today, you can hand out as a flyer. There's also some little ones in the back there on the table you could pick up. So if you have anybody at work you might want to invite, or neighborhood, anything, we would appreciate you doing that. A couple other things. We do have a mini mission project that I mentioned last week because it's only a one-day event. We're collecting socks, so multi-packs of white crew socks for men and women sizes only for Malta, a ministry for the homeless. So we appreciate it. There will be a container at the church. So if you want to help us with that, that would be greatly appreciated by us and by all of us. Okay, also immediately following the service today, over in this corner, we're going to be having Safe Harbor training. That's for anybody who signed up to help in BPS. These are some practical procedures we follow for giving safety both to the church and for people working and for the children involved. So that would be about 15 minutes, and George Kendall will be doing that for us. So thank you for that. And then we just would like to covet your prayer. So if you would just pray in earnest for the next, like basically 10 days now, pray for, you know, the children coming, that they'll have open hearts, open ears, pray for the workers, keep them well. And we pray for families involved. Some of these kids who come have never been exposed to church or to things of the Lord before, so we pray for them. Pray for all the details of, BBS to come together, that we haven't forgotten something, overlooked anything. So we just pray for all that. We just thank you for your willingness to help if you're helping, and of course your prayers very much. Thank you.
So keep Vacation Bible School in your prayers, as she has already shared. It gives us a great opportunity not only to reach people in our area and our community, but it also gives us an opportunity to shine for the Lord. So let's pray that things go together well and the weather cooperates and nothing interferes with our ability to share the good news of Jesus Christ with children this summer. As we prepare to continue in our service, let's bow for a word of prayer and silently pray as we prepare to meet the Lord through scripture and through song and message.
Psalm this morning in Psalm 130. This is, starts out with, "Out of the depths I have cried to thee, O Lord." So it's a good psalm for submariners and I guess for VBS this week. For those of you who are going to be helping with VBS, I'm the one that's going to be doing the training on the procedures for working with children over here. Psalm 130. Out of the depths I have cried to thee, O Lord. Lord, hear my voice. Let thine ears be attentive to the voice of my supplication. If thou, Lord, shouldst mark iniquities, O Lord, who can stand? But there is forgiveness with thee, that thou mayest be feared. I wait for the Lord, my soul doth wait, and in his word do I hope. My soul waits for the Lord more than the watchman for the morning. Indeed, more than the watchman for the morning. O Israel, hope in the Lord, for with the Lord there is loving kindness, and with him is abundant redemption. And he will redeem Israel from all his iniquities. Let's pray. Father, we do thank you for your loving kindness that you show to us and the assurance we have that you do forgive us for the sins that so easily overtake us. Lord, we are greatly comforted by Scripture that tells of your love for us and that you watch over us. We pray that as we meet this morning that we will be attentive to your voice, that in all that we do, you will be glorified and have freedom to move on us. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's stand as we continue to lift our praise to the Lord.
Thank you.
before the service this morning. Thinking about when we, Deb and I first got here, that mid-70s, you know, a young couple in the Navy, with a little baby, and we're here, this place was, there wasn't much here, there was a little projection booth, and they'd show movies sometimes, and off the highway there. Thinking also about it. It's great to see Gene Watkers here. It's been a while. And when we were first here, she was Gene Drake. And Father Carol's visiting. It's good to see her here too. It's appropriate for us for her to be here because, you know, Albert and Gene had a great deal to do with our church. Back even so many parts, Deb and I were teaching in the junior part when we first got here. And I remember going to the Drake's house and they had a swim party there for the kids in the pool they had out there in the backyard. And Bethel Park, look at that huge amount of that Albert had to do with this facility here. The benches were sitting on. We, back in the 70s, we never would have thought about what was going to be taking place in our church over the intervening times. But the same God in control back then and now. He's still at work. We've had a lot of changes the last few years. Nobody knew where we were going to be going. None of our political leaders. Our church leaders have clue what was going on. But God did, and He's got this. And we don't know where we're going to be in a year from now, or 2 years from now. Any of these things. But we do know that God is in charge, and He's in control. So I ask you to pray silently, that God is in control. Fathers, with grateful hearts that we come to you as a church to bring our praise, bring our thanks, bring our requests to you. We do thank you for the way that you have shown yourself to be faithful over many years. Each of our individual lives and individual families and the life of this church. We thank you for the many brothers and sisters who have faithfully served you over the years and have worked to be your instruments in our community, in our lives. We thank you for their faithfulness, and we pray that you would continue to work among us, that you would continue to lead us and guide us, that you would be with the folks that you bring here. We'd have they're just representative of so many others who depend on it. We are thinking of it. We ask that you continue to deal with those who are unable to be here week after week because of infirmity or illness. And we ask that you would hold them close. We pray for the ministries of this church. Ask that you would be with the Vacation Bible School that's coming up. We ask that you would be with each person that has a part in it, both as a leader and the kids that will be attending. We pray that you would be honored and glorified, and that those that attend could draw closer to you and understanding of your hope in their lives. We pray for the direction this church will be going through the rest of the summer and into the fall season. We ask that you would guide us and lead us and give us wisdom concerning the ways that you are leading us. We pray the same for our country. We ask that you would be with our leaders at every level, that they would be led and guided by you. You would continue to bless us. The country has many freedoms, the freedom to worship and to serve you as you guide us. We pray now that as we continue our service, that you would be with each part, you would be with the SES here, you would be with each person that's here this morning, and those who will be watching from home. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's stand as we sing some more songs of praise.
Thank you.
to receive our tithes and our offering. Let's bow for a word of prayer. Our God and our Father, we thank you for your constant care and provision for our lives. We thank you that we always have you to go with and go to when we have struggles in our lives. We thank you that you are there to watch over us and protect us. And so many things that you do that we take for granted, and yet, in the midst of this service, it is our desire to declare our gratitude for your watch care. We pray that you will bless offerings that are received this day and use it to further your kingdom. For it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Psalm 46:10, be still and know that I am God.
Oh, yeah.
What a great place to have church. Outdoors. I just want you to know that the fox came back through while Debbie was singing, and he did stop and listen for a little bit. Please take out your Bibles and turn to the book of Mark. Mark chapter 5. One of the things that we are learning as followers of Jesus Christ, all we need to do is believe and trust Him, and great things will happen. In Mark chapter 5, verse 25, we read one of those situations where the power of God was demonstrated. And a woman who had a hemorrhage for 12 years had endured much at the hands of many physicians and had spent all that she had and was not helped at all, but rather had grown worse. After hearing about Jesus, came up in the crowd behind Him and touched His cloak. For she thought, "If I just touch His garments, I shall get well." And immediately the flow of her blood was dried up, and she felt in her body that she was healed of her affliction. And immediately Jesus perceived in Himself that the power proceeding from Him had gone forth, turned around in the crowd and said, "Who touched my garments?" And His disciples said to Him, "You see the multitude pressing on you, and you say, 'Who touched me?'" And He looked around to see the woman who had done this. But the woman, fearing and trembling, aware of what had happened to her, came and fell down before Him and told Him the whole truth. And He said to her, "Daughter, your faith made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your affliction." God always blesses us when we read from His word. Let's pray. Our God and our Father, we thank You for experiences in Your word that teach us that it's not just about concepts, but it's about reality as well. And we thank You for what this story, this situation, shares with us. We can't be there because we're so many years removed. But because of what has been penned, we can experience what happened there and allow it to touch our lives. So, Father, as I share this day, I pray that the words in my mouth, the meditations from my heart, may become acceptable in Your sight. I also pray that You would clear all distractions from us, that our eyes, that our hearts, that our very spirit would be in tune and focused upon You. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Bodily pain can be very frustrating. It can be debilitating. It can be overwhelming. For those who deal with chronic pain, it's a frustration every day that they face. Chronic pain doesn't necessarily have to be a physical ailment, but it can also be something that constantly makes you hurt. Maybe you've hurt for so long you can't remember what it was like to not hurt. times we need to understand that God allows some pain to happen to us so that we'll draw closer to Him. We can learn from this woman and her experience, and from her pain, and from her hurt, and from her struggle and her frustration, how God can minister to us if we will allow Him with the circumstances that we're struggling with in our lives. The first thing that we see is you can come as you are. God doesn't have expectations about us getting our act together before we come to Him. He doesn't have expectations about us making sure that we have certain things in order. He wants us to come to Him as we are so that He can do a mighty thing in our lives. This woman and her situation, according to Jewish law, would be considered unclean. To be unclean meant that you couldn't associate with anybody. And so, not only does she have the frustration of struggling with this ailment that she had, but it meant that she had to be alone all the time. I don't know about you, but being alone sometimes is nice, but on a constant basis, being alone can be very frustrating. I think that we struggled with that a little bit during the pandemic. We felt so disconnected from each other. We needed somebody to talk to, we needed somebody to interact with, and we missed the time of fellowship together. So because of the situation that she had, she had to eat her meals alone. She couldn't go to the temple. She wasn't allowed there. She had to stand at a distance every time that she came near someone. And she would have to stay so that they would understand, unclean, unclean. Imagine that title and that reputation in your life. It was a terrible, lonely state. And it was socially unacceptable. Kind of like the walking dead. Yet she came to Jesus in the midst of her struggle. She came to Jesus knowing that He could make the difference in her life. She came to Jesus knowing that He could fix it. He could make her well again. And so we see in verse 27, after hearing about Jesus, she came up in the crowd behind Him and touched His cloak. She touched His cloak. Considering what she was doing, she was violating the law of the day. But there was a feeling that if an individual was not feeling well or dealing with an ailment, if they just got near to be able to touch a holy man or a rabbi, that things could be made better. But she could also be reprimanded, because if she did touch Him, He would have to be considered unclean for a certain time frame. But she was so desperate for a cure, she was willing to take the risk of reaching out to Him to be the one who could make the difference for her life. Think about this. Unclean meets clean. Now, according to Jewish tradition, once unclean meant clean, then clean became unclean as well. But you see, that day something different happened. And when the unclean touched the unclean became clean like the clean because of the power of God. And it says to us that no matter what we've got going on in our lives, He can make it clean again. He can get us on the right road again. He can get us in the right relationship with Him again. We don't have to sit around and be ill in our sin, but we can be set free and cleaned up by touching His life. Billy Graham said in his book, Just As I Am, that he constantly preached the message, you come to God just as you are. You don't try to get cleaned up first. Why? Because none of us can get clean enough for God. We are all sinners. Our best hope, our only hope, is to come to Him just as we are. Bring all your sin to Him, all your needs to Him, all your worries to Him, and allow Him to clean you physically, emotionally.
care of us completely, and our whole being is cleansed and purified and set free and renewed, not only in physical health, but spiritual health as well. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21, Paul shares with us, he made him who knew no sin to be sin on our behalf, so that we might become the righteousness of God. All we need to do is reach out to Jesus, and we can be made whole and clean again. We also need to believe in the impossible. Verse 28, where she thought, if I just touch his garments, I will get well. She had to trust that what she wanted to do would truly make the difference in her life. She was willing to take the risk because she was willing to believe that it could make the difference in the struggle that she was dealing with. And in verse 29, immediately the fall of her blood was dried up, and then she felt in her body that she of her affliction. Notice what it said. The moment that she touched the hem of his garments, to get well, it says in the next verse, immediately the flow of blood stopped. And that same thing is true when you and I come to Christ and we seek to have him cleanse our lives. He immediately begins to work in our heart and in our being and in our spirit, and even with our mental and spiritual issues that we struggle with, he immediately begins to transform and change and renew us. It's interesting to know that it also tells us that this woman went to every doctor possible. Isn't that interesting? It's just like today when we've got a struggle. We go to all kinds of individuals and groups and specialists, and we seek to get help, and I'm not saying those things are wrong, but if it's not bathed in the power of God, then I wonder what we're missing out on. I was talking with my neighbor Ann last night. He just came back from another 4 days of treatment. And he said to me, I got to share a story with you. He's got all kinds of stories. He's going to have to write a book when he gets finished. God's been doing some amazing things in his life because he touched the hem of Jesus' garment. But this past week, he went out to have his next treatment, and they had to test his blood before the process began. Anybody who's had cancer treatments and all of those kinds of things go on. They came back to him and said, you're not going to be able to have your treatment today. And he said, oh, no, I've got to have that. I don't want to miss the treatments. I don't want to get postponed. I don't want to stick with the schedule. So they contacted his doctors. He said, in the meantime, he said, I just pray. He said, that's what we're supposed to do. When the struggle goes and we can't figure out why it's turning out the way it is, or it's not going the way we hoped or wanted it to, we need to take it to the Lord instead of getting all frustrated and wound up. He said a few minutes later, one of the nurses came back and said, you can have your treatment today. The doctor said that this situation with your blood is okay, and it's not unusual with the circumstances that you have from surgery. And so he said to me, you know, God took care of me again. God took care of me again. God took care of me again. And then the same thing can happen in our lives if we're willing to turn it over to him. God can take care of it. Just like he took care of the woman who touched the hem of Jesus Christ. It's interesting to know that she didn't want to make a big deal about the situation. She kept it kind of quiet. She came up to him in the midst of the crowd. She didn't want attention. She didn't want anybody to know what was going on. She just wanted to be able to be healed and to be taken care of. She just needed to touch, and she knew that that would be enough. It wasn't about superstition. It was about believing that God can. And it was God's Son who touched the life. Not because he reached out, but because she reached out. and into an individual. And the disciples say to him, look, there's all kinds of people standing around us here. How do you know someone touched you? I want you to know that Jesus knows when you reach out and touch him. Sometimes we think maybe because there's so many people, how can he care about me? How could he be concerned about me? But he gave her that individual attention so that he sensed the power of his presence. Touching her body and healing her body. Now he could have turned around and said, why are you touching me and didn't ask? Why do you come and secretly touch the hem of my garment to be healed? He didn't reprimand her for what she had done. But he pointed out that her life was going to change because of her life. Verse 35. Verse 36. What am I doing? Verse 36. And Jesus, looking at him, went and spoke. Said unto the synagogue official, do not be afraid. See, in the meantime, there was another illness that was being dealt with by Jesus in the midst of this. And that's why I want us to understand that when Jesus cares for us, he's also caring for all those who have struggles and issues. There's not a certain time, there's not a certain way, it's any time you can go to God. And he cared for the situation of Jairus' daughter. And he told him, all you have to do is believe. Don't worry. Your daughter will live. I like to put it this way. Don't worry. I've got this. God says to each of us when we have a struggle, don't worry about it. I've got it. Don't worry. I've got it under control. I've got a handle on it. You don't need to worry about it. So many of us, when we have a struggle, when we have a problem, we have an issue we're dealing with, we expect God to take care of it according to the guidelines and the plans that we have. But God says, I've got a plan. Let me take care of it. You just let go of it. And don't worry about it anymore. I can imagine that this father may even have been frustrated that the situation was going on with this woman who had touched Jesus because it interrupted the conversation that was going on. But God took care of two situations at one time. And he can take care of all of our situations at the same time. There's a chorus from a hymn. It's a hymn that I like, but the chorus, I think, really speaks to what we're talking about today. It says, only believe, all things are possible. Only believe. Only believe, only believe, all things are possible. Only. There's so much that God can do for us if we will just believe and trust. What about your case? What about my case? Will you believe the impossible can overcome through the power of God whatever you're dealing with? I believe he can. And the thing that we need to remember is even when we're in the midst of the struggle and we say to ourselves, I don't know if I'm going to see the light at the end of the tunnel, we need to know that God's there and he's taking care of it. He's got it all worked out. We need to believe that God is the healer, not just of the physical body, but by the spiritual body as well. In Luke chapter 1, verse 37, it says, for nothing will be impossible with God. Nothing will be impossible with God. And in Mark chapter 10, verse 27, it says, looking at them, Jesus said, with people it is impossible, but not with God. For all things are possible with God. What do you need to do? You need to receive him. You need to allow him. You need to welcome him into your life. It's not just a Sunday morning thing. It's not just a Wednesday night thing. But it's a 24/7 thing. Allowing the power and the presence of God to oversee your life, to watch out for your life, protect your life, to provide for your life, to help you get through whatever you're dealing with. Whatever struggles you've got going on right now, He's got it. And He can take care of it. And it will be victorious in the end. And just as the lady who touched the hem of Jesus' garment was renewed in life, and Jairus' daughter was renewed in health, you and I can be renewed as well if we allow the presence of Christ to take hold of our lives and we're in touch with Him all the time. Let's not just be those who call on Him in the midst of an emergency. Let's be those who talk to Him on a daily basis. Because starting your day by touching the hem of His garment will make your day go so much better. So that when the hills come or the valleys come or the hole in the road that takes you around and messes up the schedule that you had, God will get you through. I love the way that verse 34 ends in Mark chapter 5. And He said to her, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your affliction." He called her daughter. He wanted her to know that there was a relationship there. It wasn't just a woman in Jesus. He wanted her to know that she was part of God's family at that point. He calls us daughter. He calls us son. That's that intimacy that He desires to have with us. But He also said to her, go in peace. And the only way one can go in peace is when the peace of Christ is in your heart. Otherwise, you got a whole bunch of things you're worrying about and holding on to. He also said to her, be healed of your affliction. He wanted her to know that she went away complete and renewed. And when we touch the hem of His garment, we not only go away in peace, but we can go away knowing that He and His presence has made us complete again. Let's pray. Our God and our Father, we thank You for the experiences of this situation with the woman who touched the hem of Jesus' garment and Jairus and an individual who had a child who was sick. So many things that You show us here about Your attentiveness to the needs that we have in our lives. That we don't have to wait in line. You can deal with all these things at the same time. We also thank You that when we come to You, You don't turn us away. You hear our prayer. You see the desire of our heart. And You renew us. And You heal us. And You put us on a path that shows us that with You all things are possible. And a walk with You helps us to be complete. And a relationship with You brings a peace that passes all understanding, that nothing else in this life can bring. So Father, this day, help us to be reminded that it's important for us to touch the hem of Your garment each day, and to walk in Your peace, to walk in Your strength, and to be reminded that we are children of the King. For it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Let me ask you to stand. We're going to sing that chorus that I just mentioned as our closing song this morning. It's fairly simple. Some of you may know it because it's an old hymn. But I'm going to ask the praise team to come up. They all want to be
all things are possible. All things. Father, I thank you for the time that we've been able to have here this morning. We thank you for each individual who has come. My prayer is that even those who listen online will be blessed by the time of worship today. And I pray that as we face this day, you will help us to walk hand in hand with you. For it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Just a reminder that those who are going to be in Vacation Bible School helping need to come over here for just some training before you go home today. Mm-hmm.